With this first session, I'd like to take a look behind the scenes, what the scripture says about the supernatural and about the spiritual realm, the unseen spiritual realm. Just a broad sweeping view of it, not getting carried away, just reading what the scriptures say about this subject matter. Because in the class, my intention of this class, Supernatural Christianity, is we want to begin looking at the Bible and at life with a clearer understanding of the unseen spiritual realm. We want to get a better view of that. And living in our modern time and in our modern world, we hold tainted filters based upon presumptions, religious traditions, and rationalism that clouds our vision. And what I really desire to do in the time that we're together in the scripture is to bust through some of these presumptions and religious traditions and the rationalism that has caused us not to see more clearly and to receive more of the power of God into our lives. What I mean by the word presumptions is notions or concepts that are taken as truth and often used as the basis of other ideas, although it's not known to be certain to be truth. That's an assumption. It's not based upon the scripture. It's just assumed to be accurate. Like it's assumed by most people or many people that angels have wings and that they appear with wings all the time, or cherubim are little baby-like creatures. That's a presumption that is incorrect. And then what I mean by rationalism is the belief of the theory that opinions and actions should be based on human reason and human knowledge rather than on God and His immutable word. And this is something that, again, in our modern time, rationalism is a major issue and a major stumbling block for us to see the spiritual realm. The first three chapters of the Bible reveal the spiritual realm and its impact on humanity. You can't get through the first three chapters of the scriptures and not see this. We see that God was, obviously God is there, those who were with Him when He or during the time of creation, the serpent and then the cherubim are all a part of the unseen spiritual realm. In Genesis chapter 1, in verse 26, it says, "And God said, let us make man in our image, according to our likeness, and let them rule over the fish of the sea, over the birds of the sky, over the cattle, and over all the earth, and over every creeping thing that creeps on the earth." In this verse here, I want to bring to your attention, it says, "Let us make man in our image according to our likeness." That certainly implies that there were others there with him when creation took place. And when we go to the book of Job, we start to get some understanding as to who the us and the our are or were that were there when God created the heavens and the earth. In Job 38, God is speaking, Yahweh is speaking to Job. He's helping Job to be humbled. And where were you, Job, when I, Yahweh, laid the foundation of the earth? Tell me if you have understanding. Who set its measurements, since you know? Or who stretched the line on it? Or where were its bases sunk? Or who would lay its cornerstone? When the morning stars sang together and the sons of God shouted for joy. So what this is saying here in verse 7 is that when he did this, when he created in the beginning, that the morning stars sang and the sons of God shouted for joy. When you read the book of Job in the context, it becomes very clear that the sons of God are not referring to human beings. It couldn't be referring to human beings. They weren't created yet. This is when he's creating the human beings. The human beings weren't human beings. They were spiritual beings. So what we have in the very beginning of the Bible is you have Yahweh, the sons of God, which were spiritual beings, the serpent, which is also we know from elsewhere in the Bible that he was a fallen cherub, and the other cherubim that are mentioned that are blocking the tree of life. So right up front, we're given a view of the unseen realm. And we're supposed to come into the scripture with an attitude of being receptive to these things and making them a part of our life. The scriptures reveal two unseen spiritual and opposing hierarchies. By a hierarchy, I mean a ruling system or organization consisting of spiritual beings ranked one above the other according to status and authority. Within both hierarchies or hierarchical households, there exists a diversity of responsibilities and jurisdictions. In Revelation, take a look at the book of Revelation, please. In Revelation chapter 4, we can get some understanding of these of God's hierarchy and the spiritual realm or household that God has together, had and still has. In Revelation chapter 4, after these things I looked, and behold, I being John, he's seeing a vision, standing open in heaven, the first voice which I heard, like the sound of a trumpet, speaking with me, and said, "Come up here, and I will show you what must take place after these things." Immediately, I saw in the Spirit, behold, a throne was standing in heaven, and one sitting on the throne. He who was sitting was like jasper stone and sardius in appearance, and there was a rainbow around the throne, like an emerald in appearance. And as the book of Revelation unfolds this is talking about God's throne. He's obviously sitting on the throne. And around the throne, are 24 thrones. Upon the thrones, I saw 24 elders sitting, clothed in white garments and gold crowns on their heads. Out from the throne came flashes of light, lightning, and sounds and peals of thunder, and there were seven lamps of fire burning before the throne, which are the seven spirits of God. And before the throne are something like a sea of glass, like crystal. And in the center and around the throne, four living creatures, full of eyes, front and behind. The first creature was like a lion, and the second creature like a calf, and the third creature had a face like that of a man, and the fourth creature like a flying eagle. And the four living creatures, each one of them having six wings, are full of eyes around and within, and day and night they did not cease to say, "Holy, holy, holy is the Lord God, the Almighty, who was, who is to come." And when the living creatures gave glory and honor and thanks to him, to God, who sits on the throne, and to him who lives forever and ever, the 24 elders will fall down before him who sits on the throne and will worship him who lives forever and ever, and will cast their crowns before the throne. That's probably where the group got their name. They will cast their crowns before the throne, saying, "Worthy are you, our Lord and our God, to receive glory and honor and power. For you created all things, and because of your will, they existed and were created." This is not in our realm. This is a picture of God's throne room. He's central, sitting on his throne. Around him are four living creatures. And then outside of that perimeter, there are 24 thrones with 24 elders sitting on it. Look at chapter 5, verse 11. "Then I looked, and I heard the voice of many angels around the throne, and living creatures, and elders, and the living creatures and the elders, and the number of them were myriads of myriads and thousands of thousands." A myriad is a countless number, or an extremely great number. So there is more angels there then are able to be counted around the throne. So now we see that in the around the throne of God, God is central in the throne. You got the four living creatures, then you got the 24 elders, you got the seven spirits, and then you got all of the angels, more than can be numbered. Look at chapter 7. This is all a part of God's hierarchy. In Revelation chapter 7, in verse 11, and all the angels were standing around the throne and around the elders and the four living creatures, and they fell on their faces before the throne and worshiped God. Chapter 11. Chapter 11, verse 16. And the 24 elders who sit on their thrones before God fell on their faces and worshiped God. It seems that this was pretty common in the throne room of God, that those that were there were worshiping Him. Go back to chapter 4, please, of Revelation. Revelation chapter 4. And again in verse 4, it says, around the throne were 24 thrones, and upon the thrones I saw 24 elders sitting, clothed in white garments and gold crowns on their head. I just want to point out what should be somewhat obvious. These elders have crowns on their head. A crown, I think most of us understand what a crown is. It's a circular ornament, headdress that's worn by a monarch as a symbol of authority. Usually it's decorated or made from precious metals and jewels. So it represents, the crown represents a monarch, a symbol of authority. And then they're sitting on thrones. A throne is a chair of state. It's commonly a royal seat, but sometimes the seat of a prince or a bishop or other high dignitary. The throne represents sovereign power and dignity. And then it says they had white garments. In the book of Revelation, white garments signify righteousness, purity, and holiness. They're called elders. And I thought it would be enlightening to look at where else this term elders is used in the Bible. We can see that an elder is a person of age, but it's a person who is called to take part in the management of public affairs. In Numbers, I have this in your syllabus, I believe. Numbers 11:16. If not, it's up here on the board. In Numbers 11:16, Yahweh therefore said to Moses, "Gather the 70 men from the elders of Israel, whom you know to be elders of the people, and their offices, and bring them to the tent of meeting, and then let them take their stand there with you." There was at a certain point in Moses leading the children of Israel out of Egypt. There's millions of the people there now, and Moses is overwhelmed. His father-in-law says to him, then you should get other people to help you. And then God arranged for him to appoint 70 other people to be elders to help with the management of the affairs of the people of Israel. It says in Exodus 24, 1, and he said to Moses, "Come up to Yahweh, you and Aaron and Nadab and Abihu and the 70 elders of Israel, and you shall worship at a distance." We see the term elders used in Matthew chapter 26. In Matthew 26, it says, "And the chief priests and the elders of the people were gathered together in the court of the high priest named Caiaphas, and they were plotting together to seize Jesus by stealth and to kill him." The point is, the chief priest is in charge, the elders are there, and they're talking things through. They're working things out. They're plotting how to take Jesus, but there's a dialogue going back and forth. It's not a dictatorship where just, Caiaphas is telling them everything to do. They're dialoguing, and they're participating in the management of the affairs of the people of Israel. In this case, it was devious, obvious. And then in Acts 14:23, when Paul and Barnabas had appointed elders for each and every church, having prayed with fasting, they commended them to the Lord in whom they had believed. So they went around to each of the churches, home fellowships, and they appointed an elder. Well, what was the elder to do? He was to oversee and work and help and take care of the people in that particular fellowship. In Acts 15 is what we call the first church council meeting. The apostles and the elders came together to look into this matter. After there had been much debate, Peter stood up and said to them. So the impression that you get is that the apostles, along with the elders, they're communicating, they're dialoguing, they're trying to figure it out. They're working together in that fashion. And I believe that this is what the scripture sets forth with what we looked at in the book of Revelation, and we'll see again here in the book of Psalms, that God is, he has a hierarchy of elders and living creatures and spiritual beings that he is working with to manage the affairs of humanity and whatever else is in existence. Look at Psalm 82, please. Psalm 82. Brian Gauthier just recently wrote a paper in which he made reference to this. And for that matter, a lot of what I'm going to share with you tonight, I've been reviewing Brian's work on that paper, as well as reading the book Unseen Realm. Ooh, who wrote that? Who wrote that? I forget who wrote it. There's a book called Unseen Realm. I don't really recommend it because there's a lot of presumptions in it, but it gives you somewhat of an understanding. And then a good friend of mine for the last 30-something years has been writing a book on this realm, Michael McHugh. So all of those have influenced what I'm going to share with you and others that I've read. In Psalm 82, it says, God takes his stand in his own congregation. He judges in the midst of the rulers. Now, this, with what I'm reading from to you from what version of the Bible, is the NASB, the New American Standard Bible. And I have other versions of the Bible that maybe give better clarity. First of all, the word God is the word Elohim. And then the last word of that first verse is where it's in the NASB, it's rulers. That too is the word Elohim. So the first word God is Elohim, and the word that was translated rulers is the word Elohim. This word Elohim is used 2,250 times in the Bible, in the Old Testament. Most often it's referring to Yahweh, but not exclusively. Sometimes it's referring to judges, Moses, Samuel, angels, unholy gods, demons, are all associated with the word Elohim. They come from the word Elohim and were translated in the English this way. It says in the ESV, which I think is the best translation of this particular verse, God has taken his place in the divine council. In the midst of the gods, he holds judgment. The King James Bible says, God stands in the congregation of the mighty. He judges among the gods. So it's important to understand that this word God is Elohim, and the last word is the word Elohim. And due to the Hebrew grammar, the second usage of Elohim needs to be translated plural. For that matter, the word Elohim is always plural. We have English words that are like this, that are both singular and plural, but like the word sheep. If you saw one woolly animal thing, you would call it a sheep. If you saw a whole bunch of them, you would still call it a sheep. I was thinking about this on the way here, that when I was thinking about what pants to wear, I wasn't thinking about what pant to wear, I was thinking about what pants to wear. And I was only thinking about one pair of pants. But if I was looking at a dozen of them, I would still call them pants, right? So there, we have English words that are plural, but sometimes they mean singular, and such as the word Elohim. Most frequently, it is used in the singular form, talking about Yahweh. The first Elohim must be singular, since the Hebrew grammar has the word as the subject of the single verb form, stands. Again, look at the verse, God takes his stand. That's God takes his stand. That would be Yahweh, God, Elohim, takes his stand. And then the second Elohim must be plural, since the preposition in front of it is in the midst of. In the midst of. You can't be in the midst of one. There has to be more than one. You cannot stand in the midst of one. The word congregation is also demands more than one, as that is used in this word. So let's look at this again. I think the ESV, the best translation, God has taken his place in the divine council. In the midst of the gods, he holds judgments. There are others that are referred to as gods. Not only Yahweh. Yahweh is the one true God. He is the almighty God. He is the creator of all the other gods. But there are those else in the scripture that are referred to as gods. Let's read the psalm here. Verse 2, how long will you judge unjustly and show partiality to the wicked? Vindicate the weak and the fatherless. Do justice to the afflicted and destitute. Rescue the weak and needy. Deliver them out of the hand of the wicked. That, you know, reading that, I can see why they decided to translate it rulers. It seems like this would be human behavior. But as we continue to read in the psalm, it's human behavior that is being manipulated or encouraged by spiritual beings. Let's continue reading on. Verse 11, they do not know, nor do they understand. They walk about in darkness. All the foundations of the earth are shaken. I say to you, I say, you are gods, and all of you are sons of the Most High. And again, we will see this, but we saw it already in Job 38, that spiritual beings were called sons of God. It's not only in Job 38, it's also in Job chapter 1 and Job chapter 2, and it's also in Genesis chapter 6. It's also in Daniel chapter 3, where we see that sons of God are either angels or spiritual beings. Verse 6, I say to you, you are gods, and all of you are sons of the Most High. Nevertheless, you will die like men and fall like any one of the princes. They're going to die like men. He wouldn't have said you would die like men if they weren't spiritual beings. They would have just said you're going to die like all men. Arise, O God, judge the earth, for it is you who possesses all the nations. Look at Psalm 89. Or Psalm 82. Psalm 82. 89, yeah. Psalm 89, verse 5. The heavens will praise your wonders, O Yahweh. Whenever Yahweh is in capital letters, I mean, whenever the word Lord is in capital letters, it's always talking about Yahweh. Really, truly tragic in light of what I'm sharing with you now, that they decided to not put Yahweh's name and to put Lord instead, because there is a need to make a distinction between gods, because Yahweh is God, but there are other gods. They're not make-believe gods. There are others that are referred to as gods and that are worshipped as gods. There would have been no problem at all had they just translated Lord Yahweh. So we understand, it says very often, the Lord Yahweh, or Yahweh God, or God Yahweh. We understand that he is the Almighty God. We say he is the one true God. It doesn't mean he is not, that he's the only God. There are other gods. The heavens, verse 5 here, the heavens will praise you, your wonders, O Yahweh, your faithfulness also in the assembly of the holy ones. It's again talking about this divine council, these spirit beings that are around him. For who in the skies is comparable to Yahweh? Who among the sons of the mighty is like Yahweh? God, greatly feared in the council of the holy ones, and awesome above all those who are around him. And I just showed you who was around him. We read it in the book of Revelation. Who's around him is the four living creatures, the seven spirits, the 24 elders, and more angels than you can count. Awesome above all those who are around him. O Lord, O Yahweh, Elohim of hosts, who is like you, O mighty Yah? Your faithfulness also surrounds you. And it goes on, you rule with this, and it goes on from there. Look at Psalm 8, please. Psalm chapter 8. Again, my purpose in this initial session of the class on supernatural Christianity isn't to give you a comprehensive understanding of the hierarchy of God's hierarchy. I just want you to give you a sweeping view of it so that we begin to understand that there's spiritual beings behind the natural realm. There is a whole spiritual field, and there's a whole spiritual existence that is sort of supersedes the natural existence. And the scriptures don't give a whole lot of detail on this subject matter. And a lot of writers have been very presumptuous in their communication. They've tied things together that I don't think the scriptures support. It's their opinion of how it all fits together. If God wanted us to understand it in great detail, it would have been written in great detail. It's written here so that we do see, at least to a degree, if we have eyes to see, this unseen spiritual realm. Did you make it to Psalm 8? What is man that you thought of him, or the son of man that you care for him? A son of man is used, it's a phrase that means sons of humans. It's a phrase for humans. Yet you have made him a little lower than God. And that word God is the word Elohim. You have made him a little lower than Elohim. You have crowned him with glory and majesty. You have made him a little lower than Elohim. You can keep your finger here and turn to Hebrews chapter 2. This verse is quoted in Hebrews chapter 2. In Hebrews chapter 2, in verse 5, it says, For he did not subject to the angels the world to come, concerning which we are speaking. But one has testified somewhere saying, what is man? That's somewhere in Psalm 8. What is man that you remember him, or the son of man that you are concerned about him? For you have made him for a little while lower than the angels. You have crowned him with glory and honor and have appointed him over the works of his hands. And you have put all things in subjection under his feet. When they translated this verse from Hebrews 8 into the New Testament in the Greek, they didn't put the word God, they put the word angels because it was the word Elohim. Go back to Psalm 8. I have on the screen some other translations. The ESV, again, is very good. Yet you have made him a little lower than the heavenly beings. That so for Elohim, they put heavenly beings. You have made him, man, mankind, humans, a little lower than heavenly beings. And crowned him, mankind, with glory and honor. The King James even acknowledges this, for thou hast made him a little lower than the angels and has crowned him with glory and honor. But here in the NAS, In the NASB, it is, yet thou hast made him a little lower than God. It would have been more accurately translated as these other translations have it. Again, I really think the ESV captures the truth of what is being stated. Yet you have made mankind, humans, people, a little lower than the heavenly beings and crowned him with glory and honor. You know from the prayer in Ephesians chapter 3, I should have you quote it, Eduardo, but I know you know it, that it says that I bow my knees before the God and Father of our, who has, how does it go? I bow my knees before the God and Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, who whole family in heaven and earth derives his name. The whole family in heaven and earth. There's a family in heaven and in earth derives its name from our God. It says in Deuteronomy chapter 10, again, you can see it up here, for Yahweh, your God, Elohim, is the Elohim, the God of gods, Elohim, and the Lord, Adonai, of lords, and that's Adon, the great, the mighty, and the awesome God, El, who does not show partiality nor take a bribe. He executes justice for the orphan and the widow and shows his love for the alien by giving him food and clothing. Notice how it says that God, Yahweh, God, Elohim, what does he do? He executes justice for the orphan and the widow and for the alien. Well, how does he do that? He does that by motivating his people that are influenced by him to take care of those that are in need. In that psalm that we were reading, the first psalm that we were reading, 82, there was the reproof to those that the spiritual beings that were responsible to motivate the human beings to do that which was right. They weren't doing it, and Yahweh was reproving them for it. It is the spiritual realm that so influences the human realm, not independent of our free will. We have to be willing. Look at Psalm, are you in Psalm still? Look at Psalm 136. Psalm 136, verse 1. Give thanks to Yahweh, for he is good, for his loving kindness is everlasting. Give thanks to the God, the Elohim of gods. So there you have it again. You have the singular and the plural use of the same word. Give thanks to the Elohim, the God of all of the gods, of the gods, plural, for his loving kindness is everlasting. Give thanks to the Lord of lords, for his loving kindness is everlasting. It's a wonderful psalm. When referring to Yahweh Elohim means the sovereign almighty God, when referring to Yahweh Elohim means the sovereign almighty God. You see the word sovereign almighty God. That's important. When referring to Yahweh, Elohim means the sovereign almighty God overall. When used of human judges and spirit beings, it also refers to sovereignty, but to a lesser degree. When you see the word Elohim used of human beings, it's talked about Moses and judges and others. It's also in reference to sovereignty, ruling, but to a much lesser degree. One who manages the affairs of others. When not referring to humans, Elohim is referring to spiritual beings. Yahweh is an Elohim, but not all other Elohim are Yahweh. Yahweh is an Elohim, but not all Elohim are Yahweh. There's only one Yahweh, and he is the Almighty Elohim. Spiritual beings are labeled Elohim. Elohim are part of the heavenly host. They're a part of the divine council. One popular title that I know that many of you have seen in reading the scriptures, it's used almost 230 times, is Yahweh of hosts. Now you have a better understanding of the host that we're talking about, the host that's with him in the heavenly realm. He's got a host of uncountable spirits, spirit beings as far as angels are concerned. There's only 24 elders and four living creatures, but there's a whole lot of, and there's cherubim, the four cherubim. So let's turn to 1 Kings chapter 2. 1 Kings chapter 22. 1 Kings chapter 22. This is can't remember Micaiah's mother's name. Terry Crowder's. This must be one of her favorite verses. Terry Crowder, because she named her son Micaiah. 1 Kings chapter 2. I have to think that that Nathan had something to do with that. 1 Kings 22. I got to find it here. Verse 19. And Micaiah said, he's talking to Ahab, "Therefore, hear the word of Yahweh. I saw Yahweh sitting on his throne, and all the host of heaven, Yahweh of hosts, all the host of heaven standing by him, and on his right and on his left. And the Lord said, who will entice Ahab to go out and fall at Ramoth Gilead? And one said this, while another said that." It seems very similar to what we've read with the church council meeting in Acts chapter 15. It also seems similar to Caiaphas meeting with all the elders. They're dialoguing, they're communicating. It's not that Yahweh is a dictator and he's not getting the assistance and the help and the cooperation of those that he has working with him. And this is the vision that he saw. The Lord said, who will entice Ahab and who will go forth at Ramoth Gilead? And one said, while the other, and one said this, while the other said that. And then a spirit came forward and stood before Yahweh and said, I will entice him. And Yahweh said to him, how? And he said, I will go out and put a deceiving spirit in the mouth of all his prophets. And then he said, you are to entice him and also prevail. Go and do so. Now, therefore, behold, Yahweh has put the deceiving spirits in the mouth of all these your prophets, and Yahweh has proclaimed disaster against you. It gives you an idea, a little glimpse of how this works. The council, don't get lost in the particular message there. I just wanted you to see that there's a group working together with the sovereign Elohim, Yahweh. And then we're going to look in more detail to look at Exodus 20. And in Exodus 20, we'll see the Ten Commandments. But in order to really grab hold of the significance of the Ten Commandments, the first two commandments, it seems imperative to me that we take a break